Good morning, students. Welcome to online class. Students, today we are going to read chapter 3, that is Money and Banking, from the book Introductory Macroeconomics. Students, today we are going to cover the following topics from this chapter. Here are the topics: money multiplier, demand deposits, official reserves, marginal requirement, and functions of central bank, that is functions of RBI, all the six functions. So these topics, students, we are going to cover today. Please be attentive, watch this video carefully, and listen to the lecture given by me. From this lesson, in the board examinations, some questions will be definitely asked. So students, our first topic is money multiplier. What is meant by money multiplier? Students, money multiplier is also having another name, that is called credit multiplier. We can call money multiplier as well as we can call it as what? Credit multiplier. So money multiplier or credit multiplier always indicates the maximum amount of additional money, that the commercial bank can legally create. I repeat, money multiplier, I mean how to increase the money in the banks, how to create money in the banks. So money multiplier or credit multiplier indicates the maximum amount of additional money that the commercial banks could create at a particular point of time. Now this money multiplier is having one formula. The formula is K is equal to 1 by LRR. K is equal to 1 by LRR. Here, K means money multiplier. That means in economics, in this chapter, K is nothing but called money multiplier. The symbol is money multiplier K. And 1 by LLR. Here LLR means legal reserve ratio. Legal reserve ratio. So 1 by LLR, nothing but that is the formula. I mean K is equal to 1 by LLR is the formula for money multiplier. So here LLR is reserve requirement. LLR is the reserve requirement as a percentage of demand deposits of the commercial banks. Now, I will give an example how to calculate this one. The question is, if reserve requirement is equal to 10% of deposits, if reserve requirement is equal to 10% of the deposits, then the credit multiplier or money multiplier is equal to 1 by 10%. I mean 1 by 10% is equal to 10. Here K means money multiplier, 1 by 10% is equal to 10. Okay, now this implies that the commercial banks can create credit 10 times of their additional cash reserves. This implies that the commercial banks can create credit 10 times of their additional cash reserves. Two ratios that play an important role in the determination of the value of money. There are two ratios that always play an important role in the determination of the value of money multiplier. So what are those two ratios? Number one, CRR, cash reserve ratio. That is the first one. And second is what? CDR, cash deposit ratio. So CRR and CDR, both are the ratios that play an important role in the determination of the value of money multiplier. Now, suppose higher the CRR, that means if the CRR is very higher, then the money multiplier will be lower. I repeat, higher CRR, lower the volume of credit creation. If the CRR is higher, then the credit creation will be lower, or vice versa. Vice versa means opposite. Suppose if the CRR is lower, then the credit creation will be higher. Similarly, CDR, cash deposit ratio, tells us how much of additional cash be released by the RBI. CDR tells us that how much of additional cash can be released by the RBI and received by the public is actually deposited in the bank. So this is about money multiplier, students. Now we are moving to next topic, that is demand deposits. What are demand deposits? So demand deposits can be answered in a single sentence. Demand deposits can be answered in a single sentence like this. Demand deposits are payable on demand. Demand deposits are payable on demand, either through check or otherwise. Here otherwise indicates what? The withdrawal form. I repeat, demand deposits are payable on demand. Demand deposits are those deposits which are payable on demand, either through check or otherwise. Along with demand deposits, I may tell you one more sentence, that is called what are time deposits, so that you can differentiate demand deposits and time deposits easier. What are time deposits? Time deposits are deposits for a fixed period of time. It may be in the days or years. I repeat, time deposits are those deposits for a fixed period of time, maybe days, months or years. Okay. Now students, here, once again I repeat, demand deposits refers to the checkable deposits which are repayable by the banks on demand. They are repayable by the bank on demand through check or otherwise. They do not carry any sort of interest. The demand deposits do not carry any sort of interest. And the depositor can make n number of transactions for deposit or withdrawal of money. The depositor can do number of transactions either for withdrawal of money or deposit of money. Now we are going to another topic, that is called official reserves. What are official reserves? Listen students, transactions or those transactions which are done by central bank, or I can say transactions by a central bank that causes changes in its official reserves is called official reserve. I repeat, transactions by a central bank that cause changes in its official reserves is called official reserves. These are usually purchase or sale of its own currency in the exchange market, in exchange for foreign currencies or other foreign currency denominated assets. They may be autonomous receipts and autonomous payments or disequilibrium. You know, when there will be disequilibrium, when there occurs deficit or surplus in balance of payments. So whenever there will be disequilibrium in a balance of payments, either surplus or deficit at that time, or when we need to make autonomous receipt, when we are receiving autonomous receipts, or when we are doing autonomous payments, then this official reserves we need to take into consideration. And who is having the right to do this official reserves? Central Bank of India. Moving to our next topic, that is marginal requirement. What is meant by marginal requirement? See, it refers to the difference between market value of the security offered. I repeat, marginal requirement refers to the difference between the market value of the security offered for loans and the amount of loans offered by the commercial banks. So the difference between the market value of security offered for loans and the amount of loans that is offered by the commercial banks, so the difference will be called a marginal requirement. The central bank fixes the margin requirements and under deflationary conditions, central bank reduces the marginal requirement. That means whenever in the economy there will be deflation, just like inflation, whenever there will be deflation in the economy, then the central bank will reduce the margin requirements. Now, moving to our important topic, that is functions of central bank. So what are the functions of central bank? Students, generally we all know central bank is the apex bank, that means highest bank in the country. Central bank is the highest bank in the country, apex bank we are calling. And the central bank is playing so many functions, or it performs so many functions. Let us read that one. This is an important topic. It may be asked in the board examination. Either it will be asked to write complete functions of central bank, or sometimes they may ask to write any two or three functions of central bank. Now, central bank is the apex bank, the highest bank in the country, which directs, regulates, controls, supervises all the financial and non-financial institutions. I repeat, central bank is the apex bank or apex institution in the financial field, which regulates, which directs, which controls, which supervises the monetary system of a country. I can say the central bank is the highest monetary authority of our country India. Central bank is the highest monetary authority of our country India. Why? Because it leads the entire banking and non-banking institutions. This is central bank gives a lead to all the banking and non-banking institutions. In India, the central bank is called generally RBI. Here see, central bank is also called RBI. So in India, central bank is also called what? RBI. Now, this central bank or RBI, it was established in the year 1935, and it is located in Mumbai. It was established according to the second schedule of RBI Act 1934. Through that act, it was established in 1935 and its headquarters were at Mumbai. There are some branches of RBI in different regions. Okay, now RBI occupies, or central bank occupies, the highest position in the money and capital market, in the money as well as capital market. And I can say this RBI is responsible to frame the monetary policy or fiscal policy in our country, India. Now, moving to the functions of central bank. First is issues currency. Students, it is the central bank which is responsible or given the legal right to issue, to print currency in our country, India. All types of notes, currency notes, will be printed under the supervision or guidance of RBI. So it is the exclusive right of RBI to issue currency notes in the country. Okay, and this leads to uniformity of currency throughout the country. RBI brings uniformity of currency notes throughout the country in all the states and union territories. Moreover, this enables the RBI to have proper control. Moreover, this enables it to have a total control over the total money supply of the country. In the entire country, the total money supply will be managed by RBI or central bank. And I can say the monetary policy of a country is framed by RBI. And generally, in the time of crisis, in the time of problem, it makes the monetary policy. The second function is banker to the government. So here, central bank or RBI is acting as a banker to the government. That means, whenever the government is facing the deficit budget, here the revenue received is less than the revenue expenditure, deficit budget, during that crisis time, that the government may approach to the RBI, to part a fraction of income in order to fill the deficit. At the time, the RBI or central bank is giving money to the government on interest, not free. Okay. Moreover, whenever the government needs any financial advice, then RBI will give to the government. So here what is said here? So it acts as a banker to the government. Moreover, this RBI accepts all the deposits of the government. Whatever deposits of the government or payments, both deposits and payments of government are accepted by, done by RBI. Moreover, it gives financial advice and advances the loan in the crisis time, that means during deficit budget. And also remit means collect the surplus funds of government, purchases and sell government securities on its behalf. Purchasing and selling the government securities will be done by RBI. Next one, banker's bank. This is the third function of RBI, that is banker's bank. Here RBI, as I told, it is the apex bank, highest bank, and all the other banks in the country, both public and private banks, are working under control of RBI. It is the central bank or RBI that directs, supervises and controls all these banks. All these banks, they are getting the advice from central bank. The central bank or RBI, it laid down certain rules and regulations to all the banks, and all the banks has to follow them, such as how much interest they have to charge from the depositor, how much interest they have to pay to the depositor, how much interest they have to charge from the loan taker, how much cash they have to keep in their banks for daily transaction. Okay, next one, what are the holidays for bank, what records they have to maintain, and time to time all the rules will be passed through RBI to all the banks, and all the banks working under its control. So hence it is called the guardian bank to all the other banks. So I said one more thing, whenever the commercial banks needs any money due to some reason, then RBI will give loan on interest to commercial banks. Clear? And sometimes RBI also collects money from commercial banks, or commercial banks sometimes they deposit certain money in the RBI also. Moreover, as a regulator, I can say RBI as a regulator and supervisor, the banks are not in the position of any malpractice. Every information they have to, commercial banks have to share with the RBI. So there is no question of any malpractice done by the commercial banks. And the entire banking system remains transparent and accountable to the public. Now we are moving to the fourth one, custodian of gold reserves or custodian of foreign exchange reserves. So this is the fourth function of central bank. So students, the Indian rupee value, the value of Indian rupee in the international market is controlled by RBI. Okay, the value of Indian rupee in the international market is controlled by RBI. Similarly, the purchase of gold, the purchase of foreign currencies or selling of foreign currencies all are done by RBI, under the supervision of RBI. Okay, next one, RBI is responsible for maintaining the stock of gold and forex reserves and the determination of their prices. Now moving to the next one, controller of the credit. This is the most important function of RBI, controller of the credit. That means it controls the credit in the country. Okay, so it acts as control of credit, which is the one of the most important functions. Since it is the apex institution, therefore can play an effective role to control and correct the inflationary and deflationary situations in an economy. Whenever there will be inflation, then how RBI will act? Whenever there will be deflation, how RBI will act? So it controls the credit, controls the circulation of money whenever there will be inflation and deflation situations arises in the economy. The RBI controls credit by using quantitative and qualitative measures. Quantitative means general methods and qualitative means selective methods. So under quantitative methods, for example, bank rate, repo rate, reverse repo rate, CRR, SLR, open market transactions, etc. Under selective, functions, or under qualitative functions, RBI use margin, credit quota, and rationing, and moral suasion, and also direct action. So hence, here RBI has performed so many functions during this crisis period in the country. That's why it is called controller of the credit. Next, the last one is promotes development, economic and economic growth and development. Yes, it is true that RBI is promoting economic growth and development in the country. How? By establishing more and more financial institutions and banks. For example, RBI only fixes that how many banks they have to establish, where they have to establish, and what for they have to establish. In previous days, olden days, the banks are very less in number. Nowadays, everywhere we are having banks, and number of banks are there, both public and private banks. Moreover, today in rural areas, villages, banking system is also there. These banks offer loans to the villagers or farmers, the needy people in the village, to start their own non-agricultural practice or to make improvements in their agricultural fields. So in this way, when they are providing credit to the people, rural people or any other people, for what? Becoming self-independent, to start a business, to start an occupation, or to make some improvements in their existing business, either agriculture or industry. Hence we can say it helps in bringing economic growth and thereby development in the country. So students, this is the end of our today's topic. We have covered all the topics, and with some other topics we will come up in the next video. Till then, take care.